Miracles, part two. We've been looking at Eric Metaxas' book entitled Miracles, what they are, why they happen, and how they can change your life. Last week, we took some side roads looking at how other people look at miracles, and we're going to run into one of them again, but this time, rather than taking the side road, we're going to mainly look at how Eric Metaxas looks at miracles. And we can begin with chapter one. We'll come back to the introduction, but just to make it really clear, Metaxas notes that Webster's Dictionary defines a miracle as an extraordinary event manifesting divine intervention in human affairs. And C.S. Lewis explained that a miracle is something unique that breaks a pattern so expected and established that we hardly consider the possibility that it could be broken. If for thousands of years, he said, a woman can become pregnant only by sexual intercourse with a man, then if she were to become pregnant without a man, it would be a miracle. That, of course, is a reference to the virgin birth. Though we probably weren't expecting ribaldry from Lewis, his observation gets our attention. The skeptic and philosopher David Hume spoke famously against miracles, but defined them as a transgression of a law of nature by a particular volition of the deity or by the interposition of some invisible agent. And that's close. I would say it's not so much a transgression of the law as an introduction of new material. But the way he phrases it makes it at least understandable. We may essentially concur with Hume on this definition, which is probably as close to a standard definition as we will be able to settle on. But I would further simply say that it is when something outside of time and space enters time and space, whether just to wink at us or poke us at us briefly or to come in and dwell among us for three decades. And these are my words. It follows that miracles depend on there being something outside of nature. At least nature conceived of as a closed system, responsive only to parts of that system, and specifically not including a mind that responds to other minds. Because, of course, if the universe includes God, then technically it's not outside of the universe, but it's outside of the parts of the universe that run on automatics, more or less. The existence or non-existence of miracles is at the root of the atheist-theist controversy, and I submit it's at the root of the intelligent design controversy, although that deserves to be qualified. The logical structure of intelligent design does not require the intelligence to be supernatural. And Richard Dawkins famously admitted this in the movie Expelled, although nobody really liked that he went off of the talking points and actually answered the question. But when pressed by the logic, opponents of intelligent design invariably resort to complaining about where the logic ultimately leads. In other words, yeah, intelligent design will work, but that intelligent designer is off the list. So we can accept any intelligent designer but that one. One can argue all day effectively that the logic does not depend on the supernatural, and that's true. But if it eventually goes there, in other words, if when you admit intelligent design, then you ask, well, who's the designer? And the designer turns out to be somebody indistinguishable from God, then they're not interested. In fact, they're adamantly opposed to it. Coming back to Eric Metaxas, and actually going to the introduction, William Wilberforce and Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he wrote a couple of books on them. Perhaps we should let their exemplary lives stand as evidence that one can have a world-changing and even saintly life of faith without miraculous experiences. Then he is explaining that he wanted to kind of make this stuff that he knew about. So he says, I felt a large part of it should be miracle stories themselves, since they are perhaps the best evidence we can have for miracles. I think that's pretty obvious. I decided to limit the book only to the stories of people I knew personally. And he had plenty of material to work with. So he says it also underscores how tremendously prevalent such stories are. In other words, miracles happen all the time. They're just usually discounted. To those who might think these stories mirror subjective accounts and not objective evidence, it must be said that history comprises the subjective accounts of human beings. And from these subjective accounts, we arrived at an objective truth. Or as it's sometimes phrased, an intersubjective truth, which is itself somehow and to some extent subjective. There can never be a question of whether such things are subjective. The only real question can be whether those subjective accounts are reliable. This is not to say that there is no such thing as objective truth or to lead us into a swamp of relativism. On the contrary, it is to say that we must do the hard work of sifting what information we have, of carefully considering the witnesses, as it were, which is one of the reasons he restricts himself to stories of people that he knows personally. In a 2013 article in the New Yorker about faith and belief, Adam Gopnik wrote the following: we know that in the billions of years of the universe's existence, there is no evidence of a single miraculous intercession with the laws of nature. Well, I would phrase it that way, but Gopnik did. By the way, that's all his note, Metaxas notes. And last time we went down that rabbit hole and looked at what Gopnik had said, and in addition to another. And then he goes on to say, as someone who lives in Manhattan and who is familiar with the world in which such writers live, I'm afraid I'm not all that surprised. Nonetheless, it's extraordinary. Gopnik knows for dead sure that there has never been any miracle. Not only that there's never been a miracle, but there isn't really any evidence that points to one.
In billions of years.
Wow. Yeah. How does he know that? Well, he knows it, of course, theologically. The reason the writer makes these statements has to do with his presupposition that this world is all there is. It can be summed up in the words of the late Carl Sagan, who glumly intoned, "The cosmos is all there is and all there ever will be." The yellow dots are where I have omitted material. If someone insisting on that strictly materialistic worldview encounters a miracle or something purporting to be such a thing, I should take that quote out, he must, by definition, deny that it can be a true miracle. If he insists that the only evidence of a miracle he could ever accept must be naturalistic evidence, then there obviously can never be any such evidence. This is a closed system, impervious to actual evidence. Skipping on down, I knew that if I... He's talking about the longing for another place. I knew that if I so longed for that world, there must be a reason I longed for it. Why would I long for something that didn't exist? Where did that longing come from? Skipping on down, and here's where the definition of miracle comes in. So we're now in chapter 1. Can a rational person believe in miracles? No sooner does the subject of miracles arise than someone must ask whether anyone can today really believe in such things. But consider the following. Science today teaches that the universe came into being via the Big Bang, approximately 14 billion years ago. According to this generally accepted theory, all matter in the known universe, more than 100 billion galaxies, each of which contains hundreds of billions of stars and many more planets, and each of those of which contains trillions of atoms, exploded out of something smaller than the period at the end of this sentence. But who is behind all of that? Many people would say that God was, although people's definitions of God and how he created the universe will certainly vary, that a creator was behind it all might be shocking to say in some circles, some of which he knows, but for most people on the planet it is essentially taken for granted. But if we believe that God created the universe out of nothing, ex nihilo, to use the famous Latin phrase, how can we possibly quibble over smaller miracles like turning water into wine or giving sight to a man born blind? Believing that God could create the universe but could not perform any infinitely smaller miracle is illogical. It's very much like saying, oh yes, I certainly believe that Tolstoy could write War and Peace, and did, but I could never believe he'd be able to move a comma in the manuscript. That would be too much. So if, like most people, we can agree with the first words of the Bible, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, why wouldn't we agree with the innumerable instances in the Bible that follow of his miraculous intervention? Examining miracles critically, if believing in the possibility of miracles is logical, or at least certainly not illogical, that does not mean we should believe in anything claiming to be a miracle. On the contrary, we should examine miracles with the greatest critical rigor possible. Do we believe in something that's really true, or are we afraid to find out? We have to separate the fake miracles from the real ones, or we do the real ones a grave injustice and do the truth itself an injustice too. Moving on, the true faith, as he puts it, is not a leap in the dark, it's a leap into the light. In the case of real miracles, they are never in danger of disappearing just because we look at them. If they are real miracles and are from God, they can stand being poked at and examined. So soapy bromides like Miracles Happen and Believe, which we see carved on artificial rocks sold in places like Sky Mall catalogs, are the sworn enemies of a rigorous examination of miracles. What is the meaning behind miracles? And I think this is a key, important thing. Miracles don't just happen for no reason. If they do, they're not terribly important anyway. There was no hard and fast definition of category of weeds. One person's weed is another person's non-weed. If there's a dandelion in your lawn, you'd probably call it a weed. But if you eat dandelion greens in your salad, you might not. One man's miracle is another man's eye-rolling, what's the big deal, coincidence, weird coincidence. Context matters. The Greek word for miracle is semaios. Interestingly, I guess the eta has migrated into an I sound in modern Greek. Because what you see there is semaios, which is the biblical Greek for sign, which means sign. Miracles are signs, and like all signs, they are never above themselves. They're about whatever they're pointing toward. And specifically, they're pointing toward God himself. In fact, everything that exists is not just a miracle of God's creation, but also a miracle of God's sustaining, because things could appear and then vanish. That, to raise the point from last week, God is not just the creator, he's also the sustainer. People have their faith strengthened and deepened by miracles, and many people actually come to faith through miracles. My own conversion to faith is an example of this, as I relate later in this book. And my faith has been dramatically strengthened by miracles that I've experienced personally, as well as by miracles that have happened to people I've known and whose judgment I've trusted. Do miracles still happen? There is a popular idea in our culture, sometimes found in Adventism, that even if miracles might have happened at some point in the past, in our modern scientific world, they're simply no longer possible.
If we believe miracles cannot happen today but happen to our distant ancestors, what we really seem to be saying is not that the miracles happened back then, but rather that all those people back then were naive enough to believe they happened. But this leads to another important question. Why do we sometimes have such a patronizing attitude towards people of previous eras? Do we really think they didn't have the sense to know the difference between what normally happens and what normally does not happen? Do we think that just because they didn't have telescopes and microscopes, that they wouldn't have the human sense to know whether something really happened or didn't? I'm reminded of the man born blind who said, "It's never happened before. If this man were not of God, he couldn't have done it." Obviously, the empiric evidence was there, whether or not he understood exactly how men born blind could have their sight restored, which we don't really understand completely either. 2,000 years ago, Jesus rising from the dead was considered as impossible and staggering as such a thing would be considered today. Since the Red Sea never parts of its own accord, it is many hundreds of feet deep where the Israelites would have crossed, we may conclude that God was intentionally doing something inexplicably and toweringly attention-getting. That was plainly the point of it. But since logic dictates that God could have saved the Israelites from Pharaoh's army in an infinity of ways, and in ways infinitely subtler than parting the Red Sea, it is obvious that he didn't part the Red Sea to save the Israelites, as much as he parted the Red Sea to communicate himself to the Israelites. This itself tells us much about the God behind the miracles. If he could do what he needs doing in other ways, why does he do what he does the way he does it? It is to speak to us about himself.
Question.
Yes. Yeah, it's on now.
Yes. If the wheels fell off the chariots when they were at the bottom of the Red Sea, couldn't the wheels have fallen off the chariots even in the desert before they ever got close to Israelites?
Yes, they could have.
it's the same activity.
And that's the point, is that if God doesn't want something to happen, he has billions of different ways to do it.
Right.
And the reason he did it the way he did was to communicate some things. One of them is, you don't have to worry about that army anymore, period. Another one is to show, if I want you to go through the sea, I can do that. Chapter 3, Miracles and Science. To force a naturalistic paradigm on everything has the effect of closing down science rather than opening it up. And that's a quote from John Lennox. And that's the kind of the start of his chapter on miracles and science. And of course, we're in a faith and science class, so it's interesting to look at this chapter particularly closely. So in the next three chapters, which we'll get to the other two chapters later, we'll be talking about the compatibility of science and the miraculous and how science is more and more giving us evidence for the very miraculousness of our own existence. The idea that science is somehow at odds with faith and miracles is false. It's actually not only false, but also demonstrably illogical. Still, it's a resilient old canard, one that peskily refuses to crawl off and expire. And I forgot to mark these two in yellow. They're my ellipses. There are many leading scientists who unapologetically believe in God and miracles, who see no conflict between a life simultaneously dedicated to both faith and scientific inquiry. And he mentions Francis Collins, Sir John Polkinghorne, Dr. William D. Phillips, who won the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1997, and then, of course, going back a little further, Isaac Newton, Galileo. He listed as John Clerk Maxwell, it's actually James, Michael Faraday, and Einstein, although that description is rather nuanced as to what kind of God he's talking about. But certainly Einstein did not believe in a universe that created itself. the limits of science. Another reason science is not at odds with faith or with the miraculous is that the realm of the miraculous is by definition beyond the scope of science. But many atheistic scientists insist that there's never any reason to speculate beyond the universe of matter and energy because there is nothing beyond that. Notice that's a theological stand, not something you can prove scientifically. They insist that the universe is all that is. The problem is that they cannot by any means prove this scientifically. Not only isn't it proved, but it's unprovable. So for them to make this claim at all is itself unscientific. Ironically, in doing so, such scientists are themselves reaching beyond the world of science. Ludwig Wittgenstein said, "The great delusion of modernity is that the laws of science explain the universe for us. The laws of nature describe the universe, but they explain nothing." These are my ellipses. Those are Metaxas's, I think. And this is my ellipses also. Einstein himself said, "You can speak of the ethical foundations of science, but you cannot speak of the scientific foundations of ethics." But here is what science can tell us, that 14 billion years ago, all matter and energy in our universe came into existence. But there's a problem with this. The first law of thermodynamics says that energy and matter cannot be created or destroyed. If this is true, how is it possible that all the energy and matter in the universe were created in the Big Bang? According to all we know from science, that is impossible. Yet science knows that it happened. There is no disagreement that energy and matter from outside a closed system can be put into that closed system. Although, of course, doing so makes it no longer a closed system. But isn't that precisely what a miracle is? The injection of something from outside this world of time and space into this world of time and space. Why can that not happen again? Presuming, of course, that it did happen the first time, which he points out most scientists accept. And again, and again, and again. If it happened once in the Big Bang, how can we possibly insist that it can never happen again? On what basis can science make such a claim? Of course, once the energy and matter have come into the closed system of this universe, that energy and matter are subject to the laws of this universe. C.S. Lewis grappled with this in his typically brilliant way. If God annihilates or deflects or creates a unit of matter, he has created a new situation at that point, which violates the laws of nature. But immediately, nature domiciles this new situation, makes it at home in her realm, adapts all other events to it. It finds itself conforming to all the laws. If God creates a miraculous spermatozoan in the body of a virgin, it does not proceed to break any laws. The laws at once take over. Nature is ready. Pregnancy follows according to all the normal laws, and 9 months later, a child is born. There's the rub. How can scientists argue against the possibility of miracles unless they have real scientific evidence proving that the system is totally closed? Doesn't all that we are coming to know from the new world of quantum physics make the case that it is totally closed less and less plausible? I think it does. And then he asks, what if science itself points to beyond science? This is a heading. He's not screaming, actually. For example, many scientists in examining the staggering order of the universe have come to the conclusion that it did not come into being randomly, but instead must have been designed by some kind of intelligence, by a designer. What if the scientific evidence for design is overwhelming? And it is perfectly logical to consider the idea that the appearance of intelligence must signal actual intelligence. If we find the 10-foot-tall letters HELP dug into the sand on a deserted island, who among us could believe those marks perhaps had been formed by the natural, non-rational forces of water and wind? Just 10 years ago, probably the most prominent atheist of the 20th century, Antony Flew, concluded that God must have designed the universe. It was shocking news and made international headlines. Flew came to believe that the extraordinarily complex genetic code in DNA simply could not be accounted for naturalistically. It is a remarkable thing that Flew had the humility and the intellectual honesty to do a public about-face on all he had stood for and taught for 5 decades. Convincing reasonable people that something happened and proving that something happened are not the same thing. If we are talking about a miracle like the resurrection of Jesus, we cannot prove that it happened any more than a prosecutor can prove that someone committed a crime. The prosecutor can convince a jury, and that jury might even agree unanimously on a verdict, but that's not quite proof in the purest sense of the word. Ultimately, whether something can be proved or not is a little bit beside the point. In a court of law, we talk about things like reasonable doubt. And again, I didn't mark my ellipse. With regard to medical miracles, it's certainly possible to prove that something happened. One can show before and after x-rays and or photographs. One can get testimony from doctors. But we cannot prove that what happened was necessarily a miracle. Just because something happened, for example, a tumor vanished overnight or perhaps even before someone's eyes, does not mean that we can prove what happened was miraculous, that God was behind it. And then he talks about the God of the gaps. In the 19th century, the evangelist and scientist Henry Drummond coined the term God of the gaps. It is the idea that whatever one cannot explain or understand, one attributes to God. But this is essentially a negative definition of God, and of course, as science progresses, our need for this God of the gaps diminishes. In his famous letters and papers from prison, the German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, "How wrong is it to use God as a stopgap for the incompleteness of our knowledge? If, in fact, the frontiers of knowledge are being pushed further and further back, and that is bound to be the case, then God is being pushed back with them and is therefore continually in retreat. We are to find God in what we know, not in what we don't know." Actually, those are Metaxas' ellipses. Since Bonhoeffer wrote these words in 1943, this positive view of God has been increasingly affirmed. As scientific knowledge increases, we have more evidence, not less, pointing to a creator. For example, as recently as March 2014, astronomers announced the discovery of what they believed to be primordial gravitational waves, further solidifying the case for the Big Bang. Although I understand that claim has now been retracted, and Metaxas may not be aware of that. The science of archaeology has similarly uncovered more and more evidence for the historicity of the Bible. For example, for centuries the world knew nothing of the Hittites apart from references to them in the Old Testament, and I might add at this point, and insisted the Hittites were a biblical myth. But in the early 20th century, archaeologist Hugo Winkler discovered thousands of tablets inscribed with Akkadian cuneiform. This and other discoveries proved beyond any doubt that the Hittite Empire had indeed existed, just as the Bible said. Similarly, in 1994, a broken stele was discovered at Tel Dan in northern Israel, bearing an inscription referring to the House of David. Until that time, there was no reference to the royal House of David outside of the Old Testament, and many had thought it was simply mythic. It's interesting how absence of evidence is taken as evidence of absence. In the 19th century, Darwin postulated that the gaps in the fossil record would slowly be filled as more and more fossils were uncovered. He had hoped to show the streamlined, unbroken, and steady development from one species to the next. But just the opposite has happened. Instead of finding fossils to fill in the gaps between other fossils, scientists have uncovered more and more of the same kind of fossils. We have found more examples of the species we've already discovered and no clear and incontrovertible links between them. Now, this is very interesting because, of course, Eric Metaxas is living in a particular bubble of society where that fact is vociferously denied. And yet he feels comfortable saying No, actually, there aren't the missing links. But all of these things are nothing when compared to the evidence that points to the idea that our universe could never have merely happened, that it had been intended because it has such an overwhelming appearance of design. It's interesting that he keeps going back to the creation of the universe as the miracle that kind of settles that whole question. The more science uncovers about the conditions necessary for life to exist and the conditions necessary for the universe to exist, the more science points to a creator. We will plunge into the fascinating details of this in the next two chapters. So now you know what's coming next week. As the self-proclaimed agnostic and famous physicist Robert Jastrow has put it, and I'm sure you've seen this quote before, for the scientist who has lived by faith in the power of reason, the story ends like a bad dream. He has scaled the mountains of ignorance. He is about to conquer the highest peak. As he pulls himself over the final rock, he is greeted by a band of theologians who have been sitting there for centuries. John Lennox gives us the following conclusion. The more we get to know about our universe, the more the hypothesis that there is a creator God who destined the universe for a purpose gains in credibility as the best explanation of why we are here. Now, my take on this is that I think Metaxas makes several good points. And he's setting up modern-day miracles by pointing to miracles in science. If one swallows the creation of the universe, then one has no good reason to object to other miracles. I think that's true. I think miracle stories are, in fact, extremely prevalent. They're just mostly ignored because people's credibility is questioned, and it's anecdotal evidence, which... The funny part of it is that the plural of anecdote is data. I mean, that's what people say. They go into the lab and we tried this and we tried that and we tried the other and this is what we got. That's all you really can say in a scientific article. And then try to reason from those observations. The reliability of the Bible is, I think, much better than skeptics would like to assume. And this has been shown multiple times when the more extreme skeptics would say, there is no such thing as the Hittites, there is no such thing as the House of David, and then are being forced backwards with time, kind of reminiscent of how they claim science is forcing evidence for God backwards. I think that there's a very important point here, and that is miracles should tell us something. If they're not telling us something, then I think it's fair to question their reliability. And that's one reason why I don't think that I should expect the universe to just have miracles all over the place. That and the fact that if they were, they would no longer be miracles. But that if you're trying to evaluate some story and it's not really telling you anything, then I think that it's worthwhile being a little more dubious about that particular story. If they are pointless, it is appropriate to be especially skeptical of them. And I think that for any miracle story, it is fair to approach it at first with skepticism. And I think most of us, even when we have miracles happen in our lives, are inclined to do that. And I think that's appropriate. On the other hand, I think that absolute denial from a theological or anti-theological basis is also not appropriate. And I think that a philosophy that denies miracles could keep itself isolated from them by denying the evidence. But I'm not sure that that's the appropriate use of reason. Frankly, so far, I don't really find anything major to object to in Metaxas' presentation. But that's the way I look at it. Now it's your turn. We've got a couple of comments, one in the back there and one over here. Go ahead. You've got the mic first.
Well, talking about the wheel and a chariot, I mean, like miracles, you know, he could have had him floating in the air. That would, you know, that kind of thing never happens as far as a miracle, that except Jesus was floated up, but that made some sense. But yeah, it seems
they could have had a glass wall that kept him from the
air. Yeah, all kinds of things, but that would have been kind of, you know, here we're right in the verge of Halloween, that would have been too spooky, you know, that would have just been weird and kind of freaky and kind of like some kind of, yeah, there's a word for it, I can't think of it, but it's, and then the other comment was that life itself is a miracle as well, because God created that and we still don't understand how that happened, but we kind of take a lot of that for granted, but we're living miracles in essence, but we're so adjusted to the fact that we exist that it disappears.
I'm not sure it's that the infrequency of something that is fundamentally what makes it a miracle, but rather the unnaturalness of it. For example, let's say if you know, if a big three-dimensional logo appeared over New York City and was rotating and was seen by millions of people, you know, just instantly appeared, you know, people would say, wow, that's never happened before. That I can't explain that. That must be a miracle. But if it happened every Sunday at 2:34 p.m., it would still be a miracle. Just because it becomes frequent doesn't mean that there's any explanation for it.
I think you're right on that. It's the thing that makes things a miracle is pretty much precisely what Hume said, that they don't follow the laws of nature as we ordinarily understand them. And that means that if we don't follow the laws of nature as we ordinarily understand them, then we're kind of, so to speak, living miracles. And in fact, one can make a case for that.
Have you read the book Things Darwin Didn't Know?
I have not.
We just finished reading it. I think it must be by an intelligent design person. He goes into the depths of the intricacies of the design of the different systems of the human body, chapter by chapter. Makes a very compelling case that this just could not have happened. He writes on a layman's level, but with intricate background, obviously, understanding of what's going on scientifically. It's one of the best books I ever read. We're going to reread it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, for that matter, if as is looking more like more and more the case, that we can take virtually any fossil material and find carbon-14 in it, in amounts that are not easily explainable by either neutrons creating carbon-14 or contamination from outside. From a naturalistic perspective, every time we do that, we find the evidence of a miracle. But if it happens every single time, you know, after a while, people kind of adjust to it. It's no longer surprising. But it is still evidence of a violation of what would ordinarily be considered the laws of nature if you're talking about long age. And so we may have things that are reproducible, but don't fit into laws of nature that don't consider the actions of intelligent agents, and specifically the actions of intelligent agents beyond their normal reach, shall we say. And we may run into that time and time and time again. And in fact, he's got a collection of things that don't really completely fit in with a standard naturalistic explanation. And we're going to go through a few of those. And when we have that, each one is a miracle in the strictest sense. After a while, we kind of start ignoring it. Or some people will say, well, there must be a naturalistic explanation. But that's really a theological conclusion that without empirical evidence behind it. And that's one of the things that's interesting, is because when you start talking about these things, you realize that people's theology limits what they can believe in, limits what they can see. Not only just believe in, but see. Because if it's not supposed to be there, then I shouldn't see it. And if I'm going to be faithful to my theology, then I won't see it. Yes?
You mentioned that every miracle has a point or points to something. I mentioned last week a group of Adventist ladies who were running out of lasagna, and they prayed, and the lasagna did not cease. This morning, a Russian airliner crashed, 224 people died. I'm not sure what the point of the lasagna was, but why wasn't the miracle performed for the Russian airliner? If you're, it's too random. There's a miracle here, but not there. There's one over there, but not here. You can hardly trust miracles to show up when they're needed.
That's an interesting question. And I don't know that we have all the answers for that. I'm not sure that we can go from there into saying that, well, because the Russian airliner didn't survive, that therefore the lady's experience with lasagna was just simply not real. And that's, you know, I have seen that kind of stuff. A friend of mine who has told his experience several times in public, and it's been very interesting to watch the way he tells it, which is slowly changed in emphasis in time, had lymphoma, got anointed, the lymphoma just quit. They discovered he had a very rare antibody that fought his particular lymphoma and apparently may have been able to knock it down. And he had those same questions. Why him? And why not somebody else? And interestingly, the way he tells it, he was a missionary in Thailand for a while. The way he tells it, the only other experience of anointing that he's seen where somebody actually got well was a man who went on to 3 months later leave his wife and live a life that would not bring honor to the Lord in any way. And he was left with the question, why God healed that guy and not some other people who seemed to be more worthy, shall we say?
When I was in college, our college chaplain became ill. And a prayer circle was set up, so there was somebody praying 24/7. The news went out, thousands, tens of thousands, I suppose, of people joined in the prayers. It was a movement, and the guy died.
Now, I think we're left with questions like that, and they're fair questions to ask. On the other hand, they don't negate the evidence. And that's where I think we have to wrestle with, is we can ask the question, why one and not another, but that doesn't change the fact that one did happen. Let's see, we've got here, and then we'll come back to there, and then here, and...
Well, just going back to the Israelites crossing the Red Sea, if you're walking through a couple hundred feet of water pile on each side, that's quite impressive. And that miracle was also performed for the Egyptians. So, because they rushed right down. Oh, the Israelites did that. Well, our God's doing this. So we can rush right down in between
And didn't turn out so well for them.
Yeah, and then it closed in and they were drowned. So there was the same miracle. Worked for both sides. One was preserved and the other was destroyed. If their chariot wheels had fallen off in the desert someplace,
then they wouldn't have run down.
They would have been behind the Israelites, and they wouldn't have probably observed that. Maybe the Egyptian army wouldn't even been totally destroyed. They'd got back up, maybe some bad bruises and scratches and dust off themselves, and either went back to Egypt or continued on. So, on foot, yeah, exactly, that's the point. So, you know, there's, you gotta think of that.
Okay, down here and up there.
No, you're good.
You want me to go?
Yes, please.
Oh. My own little miracle story. First person. It happened.
By the way, notice that we don't even have to go out of this room to get miracle stories.
That's right. And so when I'm done, you'll decide whether it was a miracle or not. You'll go home and say, was that really a miracle or wasn't it? Either way, okay. Been going through a real searching time in my life and my son's life, all about Adventism, you know, as a belief system, and all the things around that are contradicting traditional Adventism, and I mean that in a good way, not disparaging. So many voices calling us, and my son, my wife, everyone were saying, how do you know where to go? You know, I'm not going to believe the theologians for truth ultimate. I'm not going to believe the scientists for truth ultimate. So God, I need a sign. I didn't say it that way, but I'm thinking it. So the other day, coming home from Redlands, I dropped my mother-in-law off for something, came back, I looked up in the sky, and what did I see? One of the three angels. Maybe it was the fourth one, you know. But there it was, just like the paintings, the robe, the trumpet, and it was pointing right in the direction I had all my questions, Loma Linda. So I'm saying, okay, now I got to decide whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. Does that mean listen to Loma Linda, or does that mean don't? You know, listen to Revelation 14. So I pulled off the road and I took the picture, and there it is. One of the angels with the trumpet saying what to believe. So, my miraculous family, what was it?
Oh yeah, I've got the picture. I'm going to charge for it.
I get the feeling that here we do not have so much opposition to miracles as a lament that we have so little control over them. Does this ring a bell to us? You see, this is basically like, how fair is this, you know? Well, I'll share with you what Timothy, when he was 3, I believe, confronted Milena and me with. one day he came over to us and says, "Does God answer prayers?" And I said, "Yes, of course. Because I've been praying for a brother, but it's not working." Oh, now we had to explain to him, Timothy. But we started late in life, and, you know. Options are limited. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But see, he could have come back with, but Abraham had a son at 100.
Yes, yes. I said, unless God makes a miracle, that, you know, like Abraham and Sarah, I'm afraid, yeah, we're going to be limited in how many. We were originally planning on a 3. But we're grateful for 1. Yeah, yeah. You know, this is one of those things you kind of wonder what is the right thing to ask for.
You've got it there. Okay.
With reference to what is a miracle and what isn't a miracle, and praying for chaplains and other things like that, I'm rather comfortable, at least I'm more comfortable with a fairly high standard of what is a miracle. Try and be as objective in this. We cannot expect to manipulate God. We're warned against this. And I would say if a person is dying and we could get 10,000 people to pray for that, we would expect him to live. I don't think this should be expected. Why? Because we would have eternal life by that. Every time somebody was sick, we'd get 10,000 people to pray for that person, and that person would live. Reality is more complex than that simple an approach to that issue. I do think miracles happen, and I'm grateful for those that have happened in my life. But I think we need to be too careful to not say anything that's unusual is a miracle. You need to be very careful along that line.
Yes.
Yeah, I like that point. Anyway, like the Earth itself, the positioning and the planets. I mean, you could say, okay, well, if we went a few degrees here or a few degrees there, the Earth wouldn't be habitable or whatever. Is that luck or is that a miracle? Or, you know, it's just when God acts, is all everything he does is kind of a miracle. I think there's really, we're surrounded by miracles, but we're so used to just looking at them, well, we just accept them for being the way they are, you know. But if you're, say, a depressed person, and what, you know, maybe you're going through a lot of depression, and you wake up, and you just see, and you look up at the sky and see how beautiful it is, that could, to you, it could feel like that is a miracle. Because just that you feel better even. You know, maybe some people, it's a miracle that they got out of bed this morning, you know. Is it a matter of comparison, you know, to what we're used to? So we think something out of the ordinary is a miracle. I mean, like I said, life's a miracle. The Earth's being, it's a miracle in essence. I mean, we can choose to see miracles or we can choose not to see miracles, in other words. But I think God's evidence is everywhere if we care to look at it that way. We have a choice.
I think there's got to be some sort of connection between basically the the issue of why do bad things happen to good people in the great controversy, and the what I believe is the limitation on God's will. That is, God is not willing that any should perish. When Jesus was on earth, there were villages in which nobody was sick. In the Garden of Eden and in heaven, there's no death, no suffering, no crying, etc. That is, I think that is God's will. But during this period of this conflict between two opposing sides, God, his will is complete goodness. He is love. But it seems as though he, by the rules of the game, by his own rules, he cannot do everything that he wishes that he could do. I think there's got to be a, you know...
That he has to leave some room for other actors.
Right. And frankly, that means that other actors can affect other actors. In other words, you can have war and innocent children can be killed, or there can be starvation due to, you know, natural disaster and things like that. So I guess the sort of randomness of bad things happening maybe gives us some insight into the sometimes random miracles that occur as well.
And I think that that's one of the arguments for arguments against miracles, because if God does miracles, then it's not fair. Why should he do miracles for one person but not another? And, you know, the easy thing to say is, oh, well, the miracles always happen to the people who are the best, who deserve them the most. But that's, at least as far as we can tell, is not empirically true. And C.S. Lewis makes an observation that's very interesting. He says, you may think that if God has given a miracle to you, that therefore you must be some special object of his care. And he says, you may actually not be, you may be actually less deserving than somebody for whom a miracle does not occur, because God can trust them to actually do what happens without having miracles. He put it in a very colorful way. And if you were a better person, you might be sent to a much tougher post with much less support. And I think that's an important point, is that miracles are not to make everything right. Perhaps in the new earth they will be, but certainly not here. And
to follow up, thinking about what Ellen White says about how I think recognizing that miracles are not common in our time, like they were in certain times in the past. Ellen White says, I'm paraphrasing here, that God cannot work miracles because then, totally paraphrasing, but Satan would have to be allowed to work miracles. Do you guys know what I'm referring to? Anyhow, it's something like that. And so there could be some sort of rules of the game that limits God's will, and it has to do with this connection with the great controversy between Christ and Satan.
We have one comment down here and another comment right over here. You raised your hand. You didn't mean to. It's okay.
I do have something.
Oh, just a minute. Let's get this on tape. But before we do, I do want to point out it's 11:30, and I know some of you have to be elsewhere, so... This is your excuse to walk out. The rest of you are welcome to stay until the discussion is finished. So go ahead here and then back over here.
When I think about some of the events in the Bible, we think of walking on water as a miracle, the parting of the Red Sea as the miracle. But now let's think a little bit of a different type of question. Sister White writes that Elisha was no less worthy of being taken to heaven than Elijah. Yet, he suffered a prolonged illness and ultimately death. So now we say, oh, God wasn't fair because he did this to Elijah, but not to Elisha. What did Elisha do to him, you know, or some such thing? And the reason why we come up with such logic is because we're prone to that kind of thinking. We're perpetually stuck in our rut of worrying that we're missing out on something. God doesn't think in those terms.
That wasn't the last of my story.
Pardon me?
I remember some men were taking body.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's another issue. Okay. Yes, I understand. Okay. Thank you. But that's a very different kind of issue. When God intervenes, or when these much higher intelligences than anything that we are able to think of operate, they operate with a purpose. They do things for a reason. They don't just do it for random chance. Otherwise, there would be no higher than random chance. There's no point to an intelligence if your actions are no different than random chance. You understand? Mm-hmm. So, then one begins to think in terms of questions like this. So, was it a miracle when Job was restored? Or was it a miracle when Job was trusted by God to that extent?
Or maybe both were a miracle in a different
Absolutely.
Way.
Absolutely. That God could actually entrust Job with the task in a very important battle with his archenemy. And be successful at it. Now that's
that.
A miracle. And this is a lowly human who is now winning a battle against an intelligence second to God. What are the odds of that? And there's no record of Job being resurrected. I mean, when we think about these things, you see, we have to think in terms of that God and the devil, they play for keeps. They don't play for fairness or this or that. They're planning on long-term issues for permanent, not this business of, well, let's keep votes up.
I just have one question. Doesn't the father have the right or reserve the right to say no sometimes to his children?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, when we pray, Psalms, I think 115, it says also that he is in heaven and he does whatever he pleases. So we're his children and, you know, we expect a certain answer, but he's the authority. And he does whatever he pleases. So whatever he gives us, we should be grateful just to that. And it is a miracle that he answered our prayers, I think. But he does reserve the right to say no. And so sometimes I would expect a no answer if it hasn't been, if I haven't received what I was expecting. And likewise with my children, I sometimes say no because it's for their good. No matter if there are 10,000 of his peers. Yeah. I know best.
Sometimes you have to turn a deaf ear to those pleases for their own long-term good.
Yeah.
Yeah. So. Okay, comment here and comment here. And then, Bonnie, did you want one or not afterwards?
To me, it sort of boils down to trust. I think God is totally trustworthy. He says no here where I thought he ought to say yes, or he says yes here where I thought he ought to say no. He has his reasons. We are a theater to the universe. And maybe things he does are being watched from other planets and fallen beings that will figure in their permanent trusting of him. And whatever he does, even if it's no, his no is as beautiful as his yes, if we could see things from his perspective. He sees all the internet, intercollected, interwoven relationships worldwide of a single choice, like whether a plane of 250 people goes down or lasagna is multiplied or whatever, or not. But we have our part, and he gives us 100% free will to do our thing. But at the same time, he is working in and around to shape this history to end up where there will never be anybody who wants sin to arise a second time.
Just one comment. It seems to me in this whole question of whether there's a miracle or there aren't miracles, those who take the position that there aren't miracles and refuse to follow the logic there, I think are in a weaker intellectual position than those who think miracles are possible. In other words, it's the argument that they have closed their minds to a certain possibility, and I don't trust as much a person who's closed his mind to a certain possibility than a person who has an open mind. You're much more likely to find truth if your mind is open.
Comment here, and I think we'll let you have the last word.
Ladies first.
I just thought about Moses. He begged and begged the Lord, let me go into Canaan. Look at all he had done. But he was denied because God had a greater plan. He wanted to show, he had a message to give to his people that he is no respecter of persons, and, Ellen White goes into it very eloquently about why. And yet, look how he answered. He raised him from the dead. He took him to heaven. And when Christ came, he came down and he stood in the promised land. So
he did make it to the promised
land. He did. So in a different way than he had imagined.
Same token, Saul, who became Paul, he was a miracle himself all his life, but he had a problem, and he prayed and prayed. The Lord says, my grace is sufficient for you. Don't ask about this anymore, and he accepted that. We pray for someone, and a miracle, we feel it does not happen. We don't know what the Lord had in his mind. Paul, you yourself, you could not be working the ER all these years and not really have witnessed miracle. It's many people might say, well, this is not a miracle, but you, I'm sure you could say, man, I asked for the Lord's help, and it was there. Today or yesterday, I was going through the Bible, and this was John chapter 9, verse 24. Pharisees are saying, give God the glory. This guy's a sinner. He just could not open the eyes. You see, is a day going to come in our own lives when we stand up for what we know is right? And the Pharisees and the preachers or whoever is going to say, this guy's a sinner. Is that day going to come, perhaps? I think we who grew up Christians, I think we can look back and say, there was a point where we know that the Lord's hand was in our lives. You know, I'd like for you folk to make a comment. Someone will say, the Lord spoke to me this morning. The Lord spoke to me. I frankly, in my entire life, there was one time I heard two words, go back. I'm out of the blue, and I fought my dad, I fought everyone in the church, I fought everyone. I could not fight those two words. And yes, I did go back to college, and rest is history. You see, when folks say, the Lord spoke to me this morning, and now I'm not sure the Lord really except for studying the Bible, and clearly that kind of voice I've never heard, and I feel that's a miracle one time and it's over. Does that happen in our lives, or is this that I presume, and I, of course, I never drank in my life, so, you know, no, I was not drunk, but something did happen, and I feel that was a miracle, and that one miracle was enough for me.
Well, come back next week, and we'll continue the discussion partly on science and miracles, and we're going to see how Eric Metaxas approaches this. And the reason, of course, that I'm using this book is because I think it's a book that's worthwhile looking at.